aim of my presentation today is to explain and demonstrate Chopin's Ballade No. 3, Op. 47. I will do this by investigating its historical background, by analyzing structure, tonality, harmony, and motive, and by analyzing recorded performances by pianists of the past. I will use Polish National Edition for my analysis. I will start my presentation by describing the background of the piece. Ballade No. 3 in A flat major is one of four ballades which are one movement pieces for solo piano, composed between 1841 to 1842. Ballade No. 3 is perhaps the most joyful of four. More somber colors are used to introduce the development section, where the material is worked out at some length. But on the whole, the mood is cheerful. According to Honecker, this ballade was published in November 1841 and was dedicated to Mademoiselle Pauline de Noyes. There are structure similarities with the Raindrop Prelude, which was inspired by the weather in Majorca during Chopin's disastrous vacation with George Sand. In profiles of the man and the musician, Alan Walker explains, Ballade No. 3 was written when Chopin was living with George Sand in Paris and her country house at Nohant in the summer of 1840. However, they did not go to the country, as Madame Sand was short of money and their mailing parties at Nohant were expensive. This was a period of Chopin's life when he was reasonably happy and contented. He had a circle of interesting friends who understood him. In fact, he was living a pleasant, simple life to which he was most suited. His state of mind is perhaps reflected in Ballade No. 3. The style is very harmonious and the structure is tight. The tension is intensified throughout the piece by development processes, which I will explain later when I give a structural analysis of the piece. I will now go on to give an analysis of music. I will discuss the overall shape, the key structure and developmental processes. The form of this ballade is an arch, ABCBA coda. There is no introduction, for an introduction would only detract from the openness with the melody introduces itself. Jim Sampson suggests the ballads unfold against a background of the tonal and thematic dualism of the sonata principle. However, Chopin's dialogue with sonata form is free and wide-ranging. In particular, each work brings two initially separate ideas together. We can see on the slide shows the harmony structure of the music. This also appears on the handout I have given you. This ballade has two themes, A and B, as seen on the slide. I will now play these two themes. The first theme is thank you. initially separate ideas, A and B, are fused in the development section through an alternation of components from each theme. As you can see on the handout, the first A theme is from bar 1 to bar 51. The music seems like a soft and gentle conversation. The key is A flat major. The B theme is from bar 52 to bar 115. The basis of notes is 8 notes. The key modulates to F major. There is a variation from bar 116 to bar 143, which involves many semiquavers. And the key returns to A flat major. The music returns to the B theme, which is a recapitulation from bar 144 to bar 156. The development is from bars 157 to 182, when the key changes to C sharp minor. From bar 183, the key modulates to B major. The music finally returns to the A theme in the key of A flat major from bars 213 to 241. The harmony of this part becomes richer and it ends with a strong harmony. So we can see that all of the keys become a circle. The key at the beginning is A flat major. Even if the key changes a lot, the music finally ends in the original key. The music is also shaped by the three climaxes in the music. The first climax appears in the bars 81 to 88, and it's the development of theme B. Some 93 bars later, in bars 173 to 182, the second climax appears, which is also a development of theme B. This is followed by the final, much longer climax in bars 213 to 231, which the development of theme A. I will now go to describe the music. I will compare two recordings by two Polish artists who give a very different interpretation of the music. The first is by Rubinstein, recorded in 1959 and published in the Chopin collection in 1991. The second recording is by Zimmerman, recorded in 1995. I will also refer to the modern recording at the end of the piece made by the Chinese pianist Lang Lang. The first theme is from bars 1 to 8, has elegance, grace, and charm, and it's altogether delightful. The contrapuntal character at the opening becomes clear with the repetition of the antecedent at bar 5, where the strings are placed in invertible counterpoint with the melody in the bass. The knowledge enables pianists to voice the parts with greater clarity. Both Rubinstein and Zimmerman express the part of the music with great precision. The music is like a conversation. The tempo should be steady with a little rubato, as the questions are asked and answered. After the theme has been stated, a bold octave starts the next sentence in bars 9. I am now going to play the two recordings. The first is by Rubinstein. Thank you. the beginning, and strong octaves dynamic in bar 9, 10, and bar 13, 14. Now let us hear the same played by Zimmerman. Zimmerman performs legato at the beginning. The octave notes in bar 9 and 10 are similar to Rubinstein's style. However, the notes in bar 13 is a little stronger and the second is lighter in this phrase. In bar 17 to 36, we can see first in bar 17 to 24, the music becomes more powerful with a greater use of dynamic contrast. There are a lot of octaves. In bar 25, the music becomes more powerful with the crescendo. Let us listen to Rubinstein and Zimmerman's playing from bar 17 to 36. And the first recording is by Rubinstein. Recording is by Zimmerman. Musicians play in a similar fashion from bar 17 to 27, but Zimmerman's playing is slower than Rubinstein's playing. Rubinstein plays lightly in a very calm manner. The rhythm is stable from bar 28. Zimmerman's performance is similar until bar 27. However, in bar 28 and 29, he expresses the music with greater force. In bar 29, he plays in a more controlled manner. Both artists play in a quicker tempo than before with some rubato. They also perform a greater dynamic range in this part of the music. The Polish National Edition has crescendo marks at bar 25, but the editor, Jane Ikier, does not indicate how loud there. I researched several editions of this ballad, all of which just mark crescendo or dim. However, they do not give clear marks like forte or piano on the score. This kind of situations occurs in many places in Chopin's music. For example, other ballads, nocturnes and waltz, which express his romantic and free style. Pianists use their own discretion with regards how loud and how light they feel the music should be played. The recordings by Rubinstein and Zimmerman demonstrate this part is not very loud, even if there is a crescendo, because the stronger part will occur later in this piece. From bar 37 to 51, the first group ends with an expanded reprise of its opening phrase. The writer Jim Sampson suggests that the expansion takes the form of four-bar sequential opening of the first motif inserted between the original two four-bar phrases. It's worth noting that the second consequent now comes in the bass notes, thus completing the process. And now I'm going to play both two. The first, it occurred from bars 6 to bar 8. And the second, it occurred at bars 47 to 49. Recapitulation part, the B theme appears. In bars 52 to 64, the key changes to F major, which conveys a happier waltz-like mood. The second theme takes the ambient rhythm which has dominated the first group and exaggerates its distinctive flails by harmonizing the weak beat rather than the strong. The right hand should extend the main melody of the theme on the top notes. The pedal is stable and follows the lowest basic notes on the left hand. The dynamic is narrow, about mezzo piano. In bar 65 to 80, the music is like a small transition. The key is F minor. The fingers are similar to before, but more strings is required for the louder dynamic as the part reaches the climax. The tempo is quicker, which pushes the music forward. From bar 81 to 87, the first climax part in the piece can be heard. It's still the B theme, but the harmony becomes stronger and richer. This is a change in the rhythmic characterization and a dramatic rise in the intensity curve during the development of the second theme. The music has greater passion and the dynamic remains in fortissimo. In bars 88 to 102, the music becomes calmer, evoking image of a tranquil sea after a storm. The top notes on the right hand should be highlighted because these are connected to the main melody. After that, bars 116 contain a very special part of the music, which introduces the semi-quiver movement, but preserves the iambic accompaniment. The key is A flat major. The feeling is very romantic and light with a lot of rubato. This part requires great technical skill because the right hand has to move very quickly. The pedal follows the lowest notes on the left hand, which we can see. This part unexpectedly appears as a coda to the work as a whole. In bar 136 to 145, the music becomes more dynamic. The right hand uses a lot of octaves to make the main melody become more obvious. The left hand keeps the accompaniment with semi-quivers and moves quicker. The wide range of dynamics gives the music an excited feel. The recording here are very different, and we can hear that. Rubinstein's playing suddenly becomes slower at bar 141 with a lot of rubato. And then we're going to listen to Zimmerman's recording. Recording. After this part, the B theme is confirmed and restated in the region at bar 146. From bars 157 to 182, this part unfolds through three distinct stages, each more impassioned than its predecessor. The first is from bar 157 to 164, which is a right-hand statement over a new semi-quiver accompaniment. The character of the music becomes more dramatic, even though the dynamics are not really strong. The key changes to C-sharp minor, which creates a mysterious atmosphere in the music. Different keys create different moods. For example, A flat major can make soft and thin thrills feeling. F major is relaxed and pastoral, like Beethoven's number 6 symphony. F minor is passionate and stormy, like Beethoven's Appassionata. And C-sharp minor is distant and mysterious. The main melody line is very legato on the right hand. And the left hand keeps the fast tempo and accompaniment. The second part from bars 165 to 172 is a left hand statement with a top voice dominant pedal. Particularly dominant ones, increase anticipation and therefore tension. The third part is from bar 173 to 182 and is a fully scored statement, which sweeps the music to magnificent climax part. The key is C sharp minor, but end of this part, the key goes to B major. The wide range of dynamic goes to fortissimo. In bar 183 to 212, the key changes from B major, like this, F major, to G major, finally returning to A flat major. This part is interesting because it comprises of the fusion of the two principal themes in a tonally unstable context. The dynamic range is narrow. This part is just like a short rest because it pushes the music to another stronger part. The last bars in this part are transitional, and the dynamic becomes stronger with a richer harmony. In bar 213 to 241, at the final part of the whole piece, the key returns to the original key. It is the climax and the strongest part in this piece. It's also a restatement of the opening theme as a tremendous duty, with harmonized light out over the keyboard. The dynamic increases to 40 fortissimo. And consequently, performers should play this part of the music with great passion. The music is very exciting and glorious with the richest harmony. The recordings by Rubinstein and Zimmerman here are similar in these bars. So, I listened to a recording by Lang Lang, a modern pianist from China. The first recording is also by Zimmerman. Too much rubato. the music suddenly becomes very light at bar 222 before returning to the stronger dynamics. Finally, the ballad ends with strong dynamics notes. In conclusion, Chopin's personal character is expressed in his music with unusual clarity. His sensitive nature is implicit in almost everything he wrote, especially his ballads. Examining the harmony, keys, and structure of this piece has enabled me to acquire a deeper understanding of what the composer was trying to communicate through his music and has helped me to form a more meaningful and sensitive interpretation of his work. And my tutor Simon Parkin helped me to analyze and discuss the work of this piece. In my view, therefore, it is essential that all pianists performing Chopin's music carry out an analysis of his music if they are to reach the inner core of his work. Thanks very much.